Thank you much. Miguel.
Hey.
Jones said you were on your way over. You got a minute?
Yes, I am here to discuss my future with Clifford Ross back there.
May I could expedite your permanent appointment?
The used car salesman of the Justice Department.
No cash, no credit, no problem.
Got it.
Mr. Hayes?
Yes.
Mr. Ross is waiting.
I see you back there. Thank you. What's up?
Michael.
Yeah.
So the grand jury's voting on the Webster case on the 15th.
And then the trial.
Yeah, I know Rosenbluth thought he deserved it, so thanks for giving me a shot.
Thank me when you win.
So I'm having a little housewarming on Friday night. I finally finished the first floor. Hope you both can come.
Sure, sounds good to me.
And Gina, too.
A date? I have the Christmas nativity pageant with little Danny, but I'm going to try and make it.
Okay, what's he playing?
One of the wise men.
Oh, well, he's in the last scene. I won't be expecting you.
Okay, I'll do my best.
See you later.
Listen, Michael. I had lunch with a buddy of mine from 15, a detective. Said they set up a fencing operation on Mulberry while they're checking a surveillance tape for hot laptops. Tony Rago. He shows up looking for protection money.
Number two in the Malatesta family.
Yeah, we can get Rago for extortion.
They pick him up yet?
Manhattan DA said he wanted more evidence.
Who caught the case?
Julie Siegel.
ADA Siegel.
Had to happen sometime.
I guess it did.
See you back at the ranch.
All right. Yeah, Joan, get John Manning to update me on the Malatesta family, and let's get a meeting set up with Julie Siegel. Yes. Okay, good. Bye-bye.
Cliff.
Michael.
Hey.
Glad you can make it.
Same. You've got to make it quick, though.
No rest for the weary, huh?
Mm-hmm.
I'll try to make it as painless as possible. We are gathered here to do a little pre-screening vis-a-vis the Judiciary Committee's confirmation hearings regarding one Michael Francis Xavier Hayes.
Isn't there a bio you can distribute?
Yeah, sure. I've been meaning to talk to you about the movie rights. Cop turned take no prisoners U.S. attorney. Sounds like boffo box office to me. The committee, well, the staff. Staff, actually. I just want to make sure their bosses aren't embarrassed.
Well, I'll leave my whoopee cushion home then.
Seriously, they want more than a great lawyer. They want a guy sensitive to the concerns of John Q. Public. After all, that's who we work for.
Well, at the end of the day, I think John Q. wants his criminals in prison.
Succinct. Okay. What about abortion?
What about it?
What's your position?
It's legal.
You're not a zealot, though, pro or con?
I don't think my personal beliefs are relevant.
That's what Bork thought.
Okay, well, you have my conviction, right? You are welcome to talk to the people in my office, see how they're being treated.
Mike. We're just trying to grease the skids a little here.
It's as greasy as I get.
And that's what you want me to tell the chairman?
I'll tell you what. You haven't called me. I'll tell him myself.
See you, Cliff.
John's waiting in the conference room, and Julie Siegel's on her way up.
Great. Malatesta and the extortion business, isn't that new? I thought it was union scams and pension funds.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me, though. We heard they made a deal to take over all the bookmaking action in that area. If they're expanding into protection, Tony Rago would be the guy in charge.
But can Rago give us Malatesta?
Oh, no question.
Will he?
Well, Rago's only gone away once 30 years ago to a youth facility. Betty doesn't want to know what a real grown-up prison is like.
ADA Siegel's here.
Okay. We want this case.
Just turn on the charm.
Okay.
Hi, Michael.
Hi. Appreciate you coming over so quick.
Well, when the U.S. attorney requests a meeting with the lowly ADA, you go.
Yeah, sit down.
Thank you. And he's getting bigger.
Yes. He just turned 10.
How is he?
He's great.
And his dad?
His dad is... I haven't seen his dad in about a month.
How are you?
I think I'm doing okay. Doing okay. Let me cut right to the chase. I know you guys have a tape on Tony Rago making an extortion attempt. Rago, as you know, is number two in the Malatesta family, and we've been working on that for 18 months. If there's any way we can flip him.
What do we get?
What do you want?
The Wexler money laundering case.
Well, the grand jury votes on that next week, and I have in this office an assistant U.S. attorney who will kill me if I give you that case.
I thought you were the boss. Must be a woman.
Well, you know what I do have? I have another case, a Nigerian who came in through Port Authority.
You just can't stand disappointing women, can you?
Well, actually, I don't want to disappoint anyone.
Me neither, particularly my boss. And I know he wants Wexler.
Okay. Okay, take him.
Good. And you take me to dinner.
You think that's a good idea?
Well, it was pretty good for a year and a half.
Hmm.
Look, if we're going to be working together, we do need to clear the air.
And we can't do that now.
I'm making a part of the deal. You want Rago. Dinner.
You'll have to be seen with me in public.
I'll wear a disguise.
Mr. DiGiuseppe, the owner of the electronics store that Eddie told you about?
Mr. DiGiuseppe. Michael Hayes.
I just sold a component system to a secretary over here. Mary something.
Sit down.
Thank you.
Mr. DiGiuseppe, the police believe that you are fencing stolen property.
That's ridiculous.
Well, actually, they have it on videotape. You care to take a look?
They got me on there. It's doctored. There's no way.
Actually, it's not doctored. And if you are charged and convicted of this crime, you'll go to jail.
So the cops are after me now, huh? Meanwhile, you got drug dealers right on the block.
No. Notice I said, if you are charged, because I'm in a position to make these charges disappear.
Hypothetically, how would this come to pass?
Hypothetically, the same camera that recorded you receiving stolen property also recorded you making a protection payoff to Tony Rago. If you help us arrest Rago, these charges will go away.
Help you? How am I going to help?
The next time you make a payment to Mr. Rago, you tell us where and when. We will be there to record it.
You know what you asked me to do?
The decision is up to you. In the meantime, we can look at this tape.
No. No, no, I don't have to see nothing.
You sure?
No, no. I'm meeting him at DeMaio's on Thursday. You know, DeMaio's is the restaurant down the block from my store.
Guys.
This is Mile. Nice to meet you. Michael Hayes.
It's a pleasure. Here.
I'm not sure if Jack explained what we need.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You want to put your camera in here so you can film Jack's meeting with Tony Rago.
Well, actually, we'll be recording him on audio tape, but yes, for Mr. DiGiuseppe's safety, we prefer to plant the listening device somewhere in your restaurant.
Oh, yeah, yeah, right there. That table right there, because that's where Tony Rago sits.
I'll check for location for the transmitter.
Yeah, whatever you want.
So he's a regular customer?
Oh, yeah, sure. Once a week, minimum. You know what he does? He comes into my place and he brings his own food. I kid you not. Homegrown tomatoes, broccoli robbed from his garden, a special ricotta. It's like I'm his private chef. Only, you know, he's Tony Rago, so I gotta keep my mouth shut and cook what he wants. You know, if I don't, I'm on the bottom of the East River. You don't think I know what he does for a living?
Actually, Mr. DiGiuseppe, I think we can probably finish your briefing back at your place.
I gotta go.
Ciao.
Hey.
Ciao.
Thanks for my help.
I'll see you later,
huh? Ciao. I know this guy 25 years, you know, some bum, you know, trust and muscle in on his business. Minnie DeMaio's there offering a helping hand. It's about time somebody put Tony Rago in his place.
Well, that's what we're here for.
Yeah, whatever you do to him, he deserves worse. Him and his kind.
Is this a working thermostat?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, it's got two settings, too hot, too cold. That's why what Jack is doing is such a beautiful thing. I mean, standing up and saying, basta, enough is enough.
Right, well, he made the right choice. Quite a selection. When this is all over, maybe I'll come back for dinner.
You do that, I'm gonna give you a plate of Monte Carlo you wanna rub in your hair.
Oh, boy.
Even your mother's gonna cry.
How are we doing back there?
All set.
Good, good, good.
You
okay.
Sure you want something now?
No, I think...
I'll make you a sandwich.
I think we're gonna go. We're all set, and I'm gonna come back from the Monte Carlo, okay? Thank you, Mr. DeMaio.
Yeah, ciao, ciao.
Yes, ciao.
It's embarrassing.
I understand. But in order to prosecute your complaint, I really need to hear what happened in your own words.
Well, like I said, I met Jor-El at the mall.
Mr. Sloan.
Yeah, he never told me his last name. Anyway, he took me to dinner at Lobster Lenny's, the one by Macy's. It's kind of expensive, but really good, especially the bread.
And then he asked you to go to Atlantic City.
Yeah, I mean, he took me out a few more times, another time to Lobster Lenny's and once for fajitas.
Tell me what happened in Atlantic City.
We went to a motel. Not a cheap one, like where you park right by your room. The parking was underground.
Wanda, I need to know about the sex.
Well, yeah, I did it.
Okay, how many times?
I think 5. And once with the other girl, Jor-El brought it with us, Melody something. Another guy watched that.
Did you see the men pay Jor-El?
Look, I know it was wrong.
No, you were right to report it. Did Jor-El pay you?
No. No, that wasn't the deal.
Okay, what was the deal?
I realize now how stupid I was to trust him. But I'd been, like, searching for something, and he sort of got that.
Wanda, I need to know the specifics of the deal.
Okay. If I did the sex stuff... Which, like, I like sex, so it didn't seem like such a big deal. He promised he'd take me to Heternia. Obviously, he lied. He ruined my life, and I don't think he should be able to do that to anyone else.
I agree. Where's Heternia?
In the fourth galaxy, past Pluto. I know, no one knows about it. Air-wise, it's kind of like Earth, but there's no war or disease. And if your subcon level is low enough, the council gives you a car. Only they call them transport vehicles.
That sounds great.
I just have a few questions. I hope you don't mind, Mr. Rago.
Hey, Vinny.
Yeah.
Hey. A special lasagna for you, Mr. Rago. Okay.
You're the best.
This is my regatta, right?
Yeah, I got the wrappers in the back.
Okay. I got the money.
Pork chops coming.
They're in the pan.
Use that olive oil, the one from last week.
Right here in this envelope, huh? So.
Mind if I finish chewing before you start asking questions?
Yeah, sure. Just that, I want to know how often I have to pay you.
You dense?
Well, I want to get it right.
$600 a week. Every week.
For $600?
You get to sleep at night knowing you got the world's most effective death deterrent system. Vinny, more Parmesan. You get to not have your face beaten.
Let's take him.
U.S. Marshal, you're under arrest, Mr. Rigg. Come on. Get up. Get up. Let's go.
Rat. Giuseppe.
Easy now, Mr. Rigg. You're in enough trouble already. Give me your hands.
Giuseppe, bye. You're a dead man. I want my lawyer.
Might need 2 sets of cuffs.
Oh, my God. He's turning blue.
Mr. Rago, get somebody. Call 911. Get an ambulance right now. Call somebody. Mr. Rago, call somebody. Mr. Rago, I'm done with you guys. I did what you asked. It's too late, man. I think he's gone. Get some help. I got him on hold. Mr. Rago, Mr. Rago, Mr. Oh my, oh man, oh, they're gonna kill me. It's too late. Hey, croaked.
I don't believe this. Rago has no relatives in the area.
None. And I told the coroner to John Doe's toe tag.
Okay, great.
Sorry, did you want to see me?
I did want to see you. Is that it, John?
Yeah, here's the coroner's report.
Okay, cool. Thanks. Come on in.
Okay.
Sit down. How's the party prep going?
Oh, fine, yeah.
I read your brief for the IRS on the food processing company, and I thought it was excellent.
Thank you.
Okay, when are you planning to meet with them?
Next week.
Okay, I don't want to sit on that one.
Why do I get the feeling that this is somehow related to the Wexler case?
Because you're an intelligent young woman. It is. I am forced to give that case to the Manhattan DA. The cops have one of Malatesta's guys on tape, and you know how long I've been working to nail them. So, of course, when the Manhattan DA came in here, the only case that she wanted to trade for was the Wexler case.
Gee, who's a lucky ADA?
Her name is Siegel.
So are you going to flip this guy to get to Malatesta?
Right, that was the plan.
Was?
He died during the collar. He had a heart attack. He's 400 pounds.
When he died, our last chance to get Malatesta went away.
So we're just going to give the Wexler case up for nothing?
No. No, not nothing. And believe me, I understand how hard you've worked on this, how long you've worked on this, but I have no other solution.
You used to date Julie Siegel, didn't you?
Yes, about 8 years ago. But it had no bearing on my decision.
Didn't say it did.
Okay. I'm sorry about this, but I need that tape.
There's a Vinnie DeMaio online, too.
Okay. I'm sorry.
I got you three guys running around in my back room, and I don't know who's who, so I called the U.S. Attorney's office. It has to be connected to the boss.
Right. You said on the phone you had a proposition.
Yeah, well, I do. Because I know Jack DiGiuseppe 25 years, I know that that heart attack thing got him pretty well shook up, so he took his family to Florida.
I'm aware of that.
So Jack told me how that fat slob was going to give you Malatesta.
Well, I'm not at liberty to talk about Malatesta.
You don't have to say nothing, because what I'm saying is that I'm going to volunteer to help you get Malatesta.
Volunteering how?
Well, what I'm going to tell you is something I'm not really proud of. You see, I pay too, $400 a week. They threaten me just the same way they threaten Jack. And meanwhile, because he's got his Goombas coming here, half my customers think that I'm hooked up.
Does he eat here?
No, no. But you wire me up, I'll get you what you want.
It's a very courageous offer.
You know what inspires me? You know my inspiration?
What's that?
The mayor. Mm-hmm. He inspires me because he's an Italian who's not afraid to put other Italians in jail. The bum's a bum, right? I'm following his lead.
Okay. My advice is take some more time and think about it. It's a big decision.
Capisce?
Capito.
Talk tomorrow.
I'm looking for a Melody Oates.
I'm Melody.
Ah, Jenny Nevins, U.S. Attorney's Office.
Are you Billy's friend?
No.
Oh, you look like Billy's friend.
Do you know a Wanda Burns?
Is she Billy's friend?
No. Wanda Burns filed a complaint against a man named Clayton Sloan. She knew him as Jarrell.
What a jerk.
So you remember Jarrell?
I went to Atlantic City with him. Have you ever wondered how you could believe something so completely stupid?
What did Jarrell say to you?
He gave me this rap about some planet where everyone's happy and they give you CD players, only they're called audio delivery modules.
Did he convince you to engage in any sexual activity?
I made it with the girl and two of the guys.
Would you be willing to testify against Jarrell?
Would I have to admit I believed him? I mean, I'm not one of those UFO freaks. I think I must have just had a bad batch of allergy pills or something.
Your testimony would focus on Jarrell's role in promoting the prostitution.
Prostitution? Wait a minute, I'm no whore.
Melody, Wanda told us that the men paid to have sex with you.
He didn't pay me. So as far as I'm concerned, it was just sex. Anyway, I don't really want to get up in front of people and talk about my sex life.
Will you just, you think about it?
Mayo was popped in 1956 for DWI and creating a disturbance in 82.
And that's it.
If you want, I can keep digging.
What kind of guy volunteers to wear a wire on Frankie Malatesta?
Somebody who's tired of paying $400 a week.
Well, then we should get him in with Malatesta before he changes his mind.
Set that up, will you?
Absolutely.
Clifford Ross.
Michael Hayes. You didn't have to leave your meeting.
Actually, I was on my way out. Is this another interview?
No. I spoke with our senior counsel. He's given us a Pasadena on the background checks.
So why the visit?
I work for the Justice Department now, just like you, backstage pass.
And we can't communicate by fax.
Touché. Seriously, though, I thought I'd make a below-the-radar run in here and let you know what the sentiment of the committee is.
And what is the sentiment?
They love you. They love what you're doing. They love your background. The only red flag, and I'm talking a small minority here, is the loose cannon reputation.
Cannon ring a bell?
Just make it by the book the next few weeks, huh?
Okay.
Michael.
Yes. One minute.
We don't want some senator painting you as Ollie North with a law degree.
Okay, thanks for coming in. Corroboration.
Yes, from the other girl who no longer believes in interplanetary travel, but she has yet to agree to testify.
Okay, so we'll get Jarell in here, offer him something. Maybe we won't need her testimony. And if you have any spare kryptonite, bring it to the meeting. I'll see you.
Michael?
Yeah?
I've gathered all the Weisser files together. I guess I'll just leave them with Joan, okay?
Okay.
Do you want me to call Julie Siegel and take her through what we have?
That'd be great.
Okay.
Hang in there.
Oh,
hey.
Hi. I was early. I thought I'd come up to
No problem. The Julie Siegel, Lindsay Strauss.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Lindsay did all the work on the Wexler case.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, all's fair in love and litigation, right?
That's good. I like that.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for your hard work. I really appreciate it.
Good luck.
All right.
Could she want to kill me more?
Actually, I think kill is a little strong. It's more like maim, and I think I would be the victim. After you. Look beautiful.
Thank you. So on this Wexler file, I'll touch base with Lindsay Strauss and who can cite the case
right.
law for me.
And I think you'll find her excellent.
Well, my boss is hoping it'll be calendared in February.
Okay. This is sounding suspiciously like a business dinner. I thought we were going to clear the air.
Right. Okay. I want you to know, I think I dropped the ball in our relationship, and, I wish I had given it more of a chance.
Fair enough. Every time we overlapped on a case with Manhattan. I checked to see who the ADA was.
Hoping it wasn't me?
To avoid seeing that I dropped the ball on this relationship, too.
Well, I mean, I was going to be a defense attorney. That was a big problem.
And getting the bad guys off, I couldn't handle it.
Yeah, and I certainly didn't enjoy your judgment of me.
The feeling was mutual.
That holier-than-thou attitude, it's, what are you saying? This was all about the kind of lawyers we were going to be?
No, I'm saying that we had an ethical dilemma.
An ethical dilemma. I'm actually asking you what you think the real problem was.
The real problem. As opposed to what I just said.
Yeah. Listen to us.
We're doing it again.
Listen to us. If some were to walk, when we were to walk by, they would think we were still a couple.
To Ralph and Alice.
Take me upstairs. You want to go sit down with the counselor?
I think we take it slow.
Okay. I mean, that makes sense.
Sure, I'll see you around campus.
You will. Good night.
All right.
two, three.
Wire's working. Let me pat you down, make sure everything's tight. Clean. Ready?
I'm a little bit more nervous about this than I thought.
It's okay. It'll keep you sharp. Let's go over it again.
Okay, you take the money you took off Rego's body. After he thanks you, you go over your current arrangement. Now you want to reduce your payment.
Whatever Malatesta says, you get out of there. We have marshals outside. As soon as you come out, I send them in.
I'm feeling pretty good about this.
You should.
I mean, this is for the decent people. Oh, I forgot the cannolis.
Malatesta loves Vinny's cannoli.
Loves the cannolis. Okay. You know where you're going.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Yeah.
$100, $200, $300, $400, $500, $600.
You're an honest man, Vinny. Return the money doesn't belong to you.
I'm a practical man.
You sure I don't know you? I mean, you look sort of familiar.
You don't remember? Tony Rego had me bring you over some cannolis this one time. That's why I brought you some today.
Not too much of that cannolis will probably kill Tony. I try to watch my weight so I can eat one of these every once in a while.
Go get me a plate and fork.
Mr. Malatesta, I was wondering, since I bought the money and all, I was wondering if maybe you could reduce my payment.
What payment?
The money I was giving Tony every week. Here, let me get this out for you.
Oh, you were paying tribute to Tony?
Hey, wait for the plate.
Oh, just a minute. Let's see if I got this order right.
What the hell are you talking about?
Hey, what the? Hey, don't touch me.
Come here, it's okay.
Hey, what happened? Okay. What happened in there?
He tried to kill me.
Wait, shot at you?
I shot him.
You shot him? With what?
He found the wire.
You shot at him with what? You shot at him with what?
With my gun.
With your gun. Let's go.
Gun in your box of cannolis, that's a new one.
We are about to turn you over to NYPD and the district attorney's office. They're going to determine what the charges are.
Since when is defending yourself a crime?
Oh, I think I can make a pretty strong case for premeditation here. You volunteered for the job. You have a concealed weapon that you don't tell any of us about.
Yeah, I don't bring that gun, and I'm upstairs in heaven with my mama.
Vinny, you just shot and killed an unarmed man.
Well, how am I supposed to know that? I mean, I didn't get hooked up with you guys to play Russian roulette. Malatesta reaches for my wire, and I'm watching my life pass before my eyes.
Hey, listen to the whole thing, Vinny. Malatesta never said anything about a wire.
Well, I didn't say he said anything. I mean, what's he going to say? Oh, look, there's a wire, just in case somebody's listening. I mean, he's a bum, but he's not stupid.
So, he just grabbed for your wire, and you shot him.
You got it.
I got it. Boy, did I get it. I got it, Vinny. Vinny, if there is an explanation for this, now is the time.
Explain? You want to understand? Well, understand that the world's a lot better off with that bum dead.
The facts are pretty straightforward, gentlemen. Mr. Sloan, Jarrell, violated the Travel Act by transporting persons across state lines to engage in criminal activity.
Not true.
I've interviewed the two women who Mr. Sloan persuaded to go with him to Atlantic City.
Not true means that no criminal activities occurred.
Ah, prostitution is illegal.
Is she allowed to denigrate my beliefs like that? I'm sure you'll agree, Ms. Nevins, that freedom of religion is one of our most sacred constitutional guarantees.
You lost me.
The activities which took place in Atlantic City are an integral part of Jarrell's religion.
Sorry, that's already been tried. You see, the courts don't buy the prostitution as a religion angle.
In our religion, the human form is cleansed of undesirable subcon particles through the act known among non-believers as sexual intercourse. As a member of the clergy,
Do you have proof of your ordination?
It would not be possible for Jarrell to possess conventional proof.
Really? I'm shocked. And his name is Clayton Sloan. Jarrell, Superman's father.
I have no proof because on Eternia, ordination is bestowed telepathically. Do you really believe that we are the only intelligent life force in the entire universe?
Well, I guess I should have sent the Klingons to arrest you. I had hoped that we could work out some sort of plea arrangement, but if you were going to sit here and insult the U.S. Attorney's office
despite
by maintaining the charade
that he is from another planet, Jarrell is a resident alien who is entitled to the same constitutional guarantees as a human citizen.
It's true.
I am attorney. Prove he isn't.
Excuse me, may I help you?
Did they go home?
Yes, the receptionist.
I went home. Is there anything I can do for you?
I'm looking for Vincent DeMille.
He's not here.
Do you know where he is?
Are you a relative?
I'm his housekeeper. He called this afternoon and said he had to take care of something with the U.S. attorney, but he'd be home by 7.
He's in custody,
I usually
ma'am.
Leave at 5:30. He comes and takes Paulie downstairs, but now it's almost 8. Plus, they call from the restaurant because they're having some trouble with the cash register.
Mr. DeMille has been arrested, and he's being held until his arraignment, ma'am.
Arrested?
Yes.
Is he in trouble?
Yes, he is.
But he's such a nice man. He's a saint for what he does for the boy.
The boy, he has family? He has a son?
No, a nephew, but he's like his own. And he's taken care of him ever since the accident.
An accident? Where's the nephew?
Back at Vinny's house. I hated to leave him alone. I put Ghostbusters in the machine to keep him occupied.
How about I give you a ride home? Come on.
Okay.
Come on. I'll get you home. I met one of the investigators for the U.S. attorney's office.
8 years is a long time.
This kid means the world to him. He's all DeMille really has.
Tell me about the accident.
He got shot and pushed down the stairs 8 years ago. That was the accident.
Who do we think did it?
She says no one knows. Maria? Who pushed Paulie down the stairs?
I don't know.
It was Malatesta.
Please. No one knows.
Coming.
Hey.
Hey.
Got your message?
Huh?
Wow, this is a nice place.
How do you like that? Coffee?
Sure.
Okay. I needed to talk to you about the DeMille thing. Has he been arraigned yet?
Monday morning.
We've made a little discovery. DeMille has a 26-year-old brain-damaged nephew named Paulie, whom he's taken care of since Paulie was shot in the spine and thrown down a flight of stairs 8 years ago.
Sounds like DeMille's a nice man.
Well, I talked to the lead detective, and guess who suspect number one is? Frankie Malatesta. Apparently, Paulie was an errand boy for Frankie.
Well, was he convicted?
Never even charged. All 6 eyewitnesses never saw anything.
So what are you saying, this is a payback?
The rumor is that Paulie was shot because he delivered the wrong pizza. Malatesta doesn't like onions.
And DeMille plotted for 8 years to have the guy down the block get caught on our video receiving stolen goods and being extorted by Malatesta's lieutenant. I don't think so, Mike.
Motive. He had motive, the means, and we gave him the opportunity.
He could have done the same thing without the U.S. attorney. He could have had the same setup, the same cannoli.
Julie, DeMille used us to carry out his vendetta, and we provided the perfect alibi.
Do you have any evidence?
Listen to the tape. Malatesta recognizes him. They even talk about ordering correctly.
It's all circumstantial, Michael.
Okay. I want to speak to him again, and I need your permission.
Michael?
Julie, he used us. This was premeditated.
You sure you don't want a lawyer present?
For what? Look, I know the gun wasn't registered. I plead guilty, so let me pay a fine and go home.
It's not going to be that simple, Vinny. You know who I met? You know who I met, Vinny? I met Paulie.
Paulie's got nothing to do with this.
No? You know, Vinny,
I have a nephew that I'm very close with, just like you. And if anybody were to hurt him, I think I would probably want to kill that person with my bare hands, if possible. You know what I mean?
It was an accident. Nobody knows who's responsible.
So, if you shot Malatesta because he hurt Polly, I couldn't say that it was the right thing to do, but I could understand it. I could understand it. Now, if ADA Siegel can go to the judge and say you've been very cooperative, that can go a long way for you. But if you try and get over on us, Vinny, and she can prove it, I say stick a fork in Vinny because he's done. He's done.
Self-defense. It was self-defense, Mr. Hayes.
Minnie, there are no wheelchair ramps at Attica. Polly will not be able to visit you there. If you don't help us, you're never going to see him again.
Like I said, Mr. Hayes, it was self-defense.
Well, guy seems pretty convincing.
That's his job.
We went in with no hard evidence. We're leaving the same way.
Right. Right. Okay. The last thing I want to say about this is you don't bring a concealed weapon into a room unless you plan to use it.
In your opinion, that's what happened. It's my case, Michael, my call. Look, I'll present the evidence to my boss. We'll do what we think is right. What's the matter?
Well, I guess I'm wondering if you're trying to protect me.
From what?
This is the week of my appointment, and it could be seen from another angle that this is a total disaster for me.
I think you know me better than that. I just don't agree with you. Okay.
Thanks for coming down here. I know it's a long train ride.
It's okay. I got fired. She said it was for general incompetence.
Melody, we thought that Jarrell would be willing to make a deal. But he isn't, so we really need your testimony.
I told you, I don't particularly care to get up in front of a bunch of people and talk about doing it with some German tourist. Anyway, I don't have time. I gotta find another job.
If you testify, I will help you find a job.
Yeah? Flipping burgers? You know, this legal stuff really gives me a headache.
How old are you?
19.
When I was 19, I think there were only two things that I cared about. The name of the guy sitting next to me in art history and pledging tri-delt.
Look, I don't go to college, okay? And I'm never gonna be a lawyer. And if my next job pays $6 an hour, I'll be getting a raise.
Okay, my point is...
How you woke up one morning and realized how important it is to get serious, to contribute to society and...
Matter of fact, yes.
Well, I don't want to get serious because if I get serious, I might realize how crummy my life is.
This isn't about you, Melody.
And I'm not interested.
Go?
On a vengeful, illegal possession of a handgun, he pled guilty.
Mm.
What, you think we went the wrong way?
I think you know how I feel.
There are two thoughts you need to live with. One is I would never bend the law to further your career.
And the other?
That I care about you.
Mr. Hayes, there's a man by the door who says he needs to speak with you.
Found your brother, Michael.
You found Danny, good.
Yeah,
thing is that he disappeared before I could make the call. I had to wait for some people to clear the area. Starbright Motel on Route 9. That's where I saw him.
That's where I saw him, too.
I know.
So then you know I let him go.
I'm not looking to hurt you, Michael. I was hoping me and you could bring him in on our own, okay? But it's been a week.
All right. Well, you're probably not going to find him. I gave him money to get on a plane.
Monique that brought it to the motel? Mm-hmm. Well, we got her tap on her phone. And he just called her a couple hours ago from a phone booth on 8th Avenue.
Okay. I mean, if I hear from him, I'll let you know.
Okay, okay. Listen, I've been here. I said what I gotta say. Okay?
All right.